One of the problems you probably have and I have is that I can be very impatient. Whether it is having to deal with traffic or meeting any type of goals, I want it done yesterday. And sometimes that impatience can lead to rather disastrous results. We live in a world where we want everything instantaneously. We can get a lot of what we want quickly, whether it's Amazon Prime or you go to a fast food restaurant. But God doesn't deal with us that way, where He's going to do what we want quickly. Some things take time, and we've got to learn to be patient and trust in the Lord. And that is exactly the problem that Abram and Sarah are facing in chapter 16. Let's read and see what God's word says to us. Now, Sarah, Abraham's wife, had borne him no children. She had a female Egyptian servant whose name was Hagar. And Sarah said to Abram, "Behold, now the Lord has prevented me from bearing children. Go into my servant. It may be that I shall obtain children by her." And Abram listened to the voice of Sarah. So after Abram had lived 10 years in the land of Canaan, Sarai, Abram's wife, took Hagar, the Egyptian, her servant, and gave her to Abram, her husband, as a wife. And he went into Hagar, and she conceived, and she saw that she had conceived. She looked with contempt on her mistress. And Sarah said to Abram, "May the wrong done to me be on you. I gave my servant to you in grace." And when she saw that she conceived, she looked on me with contempt. "May the Lord judge between you and me." But Abram said to Sarah, "Behold, your servant is in your power. Do to her as you please." And Sarah dealt harshly with her, and she fled from her. The angel of the Lord found her by a spring of water in the wilderness, the spring on the way to Shur. And he said, "Hagar, servant of Sarah, where have you come from and where are you going?" She said, "I am fleeing from my mistress Sarah." And the angel of the Lord said to her, "Return to your mistress and submit to her." And the angel of the Lord said to her, "I will surely multiply your offspring so they cannot be numbered for multitude." And the angel of the Lord said to her, "Behold, you are pregnant and shall bear a son. You shall call his name Ishmael, because the Lord has listened to your affliction. And he shall be a wild donkey of a man, and his hand against everyone, and everyone's hand against him, and he shall dwell over against all his kinsmen." So she called the name of the Lord, who spoke to her, "You are a God of seeing." For she said, "Truly, here I have seen him who looks after me." Therefore the well was called Beer Laharoi. It lies between Kadesh and Beer. And Hagar bore Abram a son, and Abram called the name of his son, whom Hagar bore, Ishmael. And Abram was 86 years old when Hagar bore Ishmael to Abram. Let's pray and ask God's blessing on his word. Our Lord and our Savior, we may not understand what this passage means to us at first glance, but have mercy on your servants and show them that all scripture is God-breathed and useful for teaching, correcting, rebuking, and training in righteousness. Help us to see that there is some Abraham in all of us. Hear our prayer. Amen. One of the first pictures, movie pictures that is, that I ever saw more than once was the Poseidon Adventure. It was one of those Irwin Allen dramas. It was spectacular, and I guess I was drawn to it because here you have the story of an ocean liner that's about to be scrapped. It's hit by a tidal wave, and there's the adventures of all the people trying to escape and continue their life by escaping from the Poseidon. Now, I was also attracted to the film because I think I had a teenage crush on one of the actresses. But I saw that picture over and over again, several times. And there is one scene in that movie that I remember the words to. It is with Gene Hackman, who is playing a radical Methodist minister, and he's on the deck of the SS Poseidon, and he's preaching early in the movie, and he says these words, "God helps those who help themselves." I have had people ask me, is that in the Bible? No, it's not the Bible. In fact, if you are a Christian, I'd say it's not even scriptural. It's not biblical. We don't believe in that. It's dead wrong. Our salvation does not come by Christians helping themselves. And we don't live life by pulling ourselves up by our own bootstraps. Now, for Christianity, God is in the business of helping his people. God is in the business of saving. Well, today's story shows what Abraham and Sarah did that was a lot like the Gene Hackman's character's words. They were helping themselves. They didn't think God could do what God had promised, and it got them in a lot of trouble. See, discipleship, more often than not, is waiting on God. And that idea of waiting runs contrary to what you and I want to do. We want to seize the day, get things going. We don't want to wait, especially in a fast-paced world where we can have everything instantaneous. Well, as we start looking into this story, sometimes we think, by our own power, accomplish God's will. Remember Frank Sinatra's song, "I Did It My Way"? Well, that's what's happening here in this passage. They're trying to do it their way, and it's not going to work out real well for them. It's going to create lots of problems. And here, this story that we are looking at takes place 10 years after the original promises to Abram and Sarah. The original promises, Genesis 12, time has passed, and yet Sarah still does not have any children. Now, today, if you don't have children, it's not a big deal, but back then, if a woman did not have any children, it was considered a social embarrassment. Your worth as a woman was often tied into the number of children you could have. And a story that is similar to this is found in the first chapter of Samuel, where Hannah has a rival as well who is taunting her because she has no children. They received the covenant promises, but still no child. And Sarah was no spring chicken. She was an older woman. And it seems as if God is not going to act. And from their minds, either God is a liar, or maybe they've got to take matters into their own hands and come up with a way that is socially acceptable, a common sense solution to get this problem taken care of. And this is where the temptation comes into play for both Abram and Sarah. Now, I'm sure they were tempted before. There was probably temptation when they were asked to leave the Ur of Chaldees and separate from their family. I'm sure there was a temptation when they are in the Promised Land and there's a famine and they've got to go to Egypt and live there. And when there was that choice between the land that Lot wanted and Abraham wanted, I'm sure there was a temptation there of taking the best land. Well, now here's the temptation. Take my servant as your wife, and you, Abram, can have a child by her, and that child can be my child. Well, today we think that's crazy, but back then, that was a common sense solution. In fact, it was written in ancient Near Eastern law that this could take place. Hammurabi's Code, the Nanzi Tablets, the Mani Tablets, they all said a barren wife could be credited with the children from a maidservant. And this is not the first time in the Bible this happens. Rachel and Leah, when they were married to Jacob, did the same thing with their maidservant when they were having a fertility frenzy. So this was the custom of the time. It makes common sense. It's socially acceptable. But is it God's will? Abram doesn't seem to answer that question, not even Sarah. Originally, it's supposed to be one man, one woman. No one is to intercede in that relationship between one man and one woman. What they had forgotten was God's providential timing and God's ability to act. Now, that can happen to you as well. It's that seize the day mentality. And we use those common sense solutions all the time, don't we? Here's one of them. Get an expert. Sometimes experts really don't know what they're doing. One example of this is in the American government, where during the Vietnam era, President Kennedy and President Johnson had the brain trust, all those Ivy League educated advisors, and what did they do? Those experts kept him in a war that was unwinnable. In the church world, we do that as well. Let's go get an expert group to come in and show us how to run the church. A lot of times it doesn't work. An expert may not have all the answers, but yet in our American society, that's a common sense solution. You got a problem? Get an expert. Get somebody with a doctorate degree who's written a book, and they'll be the ones who love you. Or how about this is the common sense advice? The dollar is the bottom line. Bottom line is not always the dollar. When Dallas Theological Seminary was first started, it was about to go bankrupt. They did not have enough funds to pay off their debtors and to keep the institution going. So Lewis Sperry Schaefer got a group of men to pray. And one of the professors prayed, "Lord, you own the cattle on 1,000 hills. Can you sell some for us?" Then there was a knock on the conference room door, and in walked a cattleman who had just sold 2 boxcars of cattle, and a business deal went bad, and he made a donation to the seminary. God did sell the cattle on 1,000 hills. But now, let me tell you, was the bottom line the dollar? No, the bottom line was God. And here's another common sense advice that we want for success. Market things correctly. Your church will grow. You'll be able to get the perfect job if you just learn how to market yourself correctly. It doesn't work that way because image is not everything. The reality here in this passage is even deeper than common sense solutions. It's their impatience. They've got to have something done now. And it wasn't God's timing. Bruce Hayward is a church planner in the Presbyterian Church of America. And he can tell you about all the strategies for planning churches. Here's what he said. You can have all the strategies, all the plans, all the experts you want, but if it's not in the providential timing of God, it's not going to happen. Sometimes, as disciples, we have to wait upon the Lord. And I want you to look at chapter 15 that we read last week, in verse 16, about the promise of land for Abram. The Lord says to them, and they shall come back here, referring to his descendants, in the fourth generation, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet complete. for those promises that he made would be fulfilled. What we've got to often do is when we are impatient, is look at the motives of our heart. Why do we want this now? Why does this have to happen today? Why? Is it because we want peace, comfort, our way? Or is there another motive that may be deep down inside us? Here's what someone said. God is not slow, but neither is he in a hurry. You may be in a hurry, but God is not, because his plans are perfect. And you don't know the fullness of those plans. And let me tell you what you can do if you move too quickly. You can really mess things up. Look at the story here. Look at the tension that comes between Hagar and Sarah in verse 4. And he went into Hagar, and she conceived, and she saw that she conceived. She looked with contempt on her mistress. Tensions between Hagar and Sarah. And down in verse 6, Abram, who passes the buck, as a lot of husbands do, said to Sarah, "Behold, your servant is in your power. Do to her as you please." That's not good. And there's this tension between the two women, but there's also going to be tension, and it's rather humorous, between Sarah and Abram. Look at verse 2. Who does Sarah blame for her problems? And Sarah said to Abram, "Behold, now the Lord has prevented me from bearing children. Go unto my servant, and it may be that I shall obtain children by her." She's blaming God. And then what happens in verse 5? And Sarah said to Abram, "May the wrong done to me be on you. I gave my servant to your embrace." And when she saw that she conceived, she looked on me with contempt. What was Sarah thinking? Sarah, you gave Abram. You practically pushed Hagar into the arms of your husband, and now you're blaming your husband? This is a mess. And the tensions go on, and here's the problem that none of them get. It's their limited insight into what God wants. Don't rush. One summer before I went to seminary, I had to work for Barocco Electrical, and I gotta tell you, it was the hardest job I ever had. That Coast Guard base, I was on top of that building in the sweltering summer heat, and it was not a lot of fun. Well, here's one of the things I learned. If you lay conduit too quickly, you make a mess, and you have to go back and redo it. Well, it's the same spiritually as well. You may think you've changed things, but you haven't changed a thing. Harry Callis introduced the players to the Philadelphia Phillies in their baseball team. He once introduced one of the players, Gary Maddox, with these words. "He has turned his life around. He used to be depressed and miserable, now he's miserable and depressed." We think all our solutions will bring easy answers, whether it is church planting, whether it is the job you want, whether it is marriage, it doesn't matter. We may rush decisions, and it's going to work against us when we try to make our ways the ways of God and not rely on Him. And that's really the second part of the story. Because we should be relying on God, who sees our situation. I want you to notice how that is emphasized. God saw Hagar, who was not part of the covenantal line, as she fled from her mistress. Look at verse 7 and the verses that follow. "And the angel Lord found her by a spring of water in the wilderness, the spring on the way to Shur. And he said, 'Hagar, servant of Sarah, where have you come from and where are you going?'" She's not part of the covenantal line. Yet God sees her, and in verse 13 it says, "So she called the name of the Lord who spoke to you. You are the God of seeing, for he said, 'Truly here I have seen him who looks after me. God was with this woman, even though she's not going to be blessed covenantally. Now, she does get some blessings. In fact, the blessings she does get mimics the blessings that Abram would get. But it's not for her that the Christ child would come. And if he sees Hagar, don't you think he sees what's happening with Abram and Sarah too, who are part of the covenant line? Why, of course he does. But you see, Abram and Sarah don't realize that. And the God that we worship here this morning, he's a God who sees you when you think he doesn't see. Listen to Psalm 139. Where shall I go from your spirit? Where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light about me be night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is bright as the day, for darkness is light with you. You may think because God's promises to you have not been fulfilled instantaneously, he doesn't see you. He doesn't know about you. It's not true. Jonah tried to escape from the presence of God when he was asked to do the will of God, and what happened? God found him in the middle of the sea. The principle here is in situations where we think God is not present, he's there. When you feel deserted by God, God will be inserted. You feel God has checked out? No, he's actually checked in. When I was in third grade, I missed the bus to go home. So I decided to do something that was very foolish. I decided that I would walk home through fields in Illinois. And I was so scared because I thought, no one is going to see me. Something could happen to me that could be very, very troubling. But in truth, I had escaped from God. He was with me. He helped me to get home. Don't think that God will ever desert you, and you've got to turn to those common sense solutions and work that way. And in fact, God can answer your prayers. Look at what's happening here in verse 11. Behold, you are present, you are pregnant, and shall bear a son, and you shall call his name Ishmael. And what does that name Ishmael mean? Because the Lord has listened to your affliction. Ishmael means the Lord hears. What should Abram and Sarah done? Listen to God. And here's what's interesting about this story. Notice, the angel of the Lord told Hagar the name of the child. Look down at verse 15. Who winds up naming the child? Abram does. Abram called the name of the son whom Hagar bore Ishmael. Where did he learn that? Hagar. I think God was trying to teach Abram a lesson. Abram, Sarah, turn to God. Turn to the God who sees. Turn to the God who is there and stop thinking about your own puny, common sense solutions when you don't know the fullness of my plans. I like what Eugene Peterson says. In prayer, we are aware that God is in action, and that when the circumstances are ready, and when others are in the right place, and when our hearts are prepared, he will call us into action. Waiting in prayer is a disciplined refusal to act before God James says, if anything lacks wisdom, we should ask of the Lord. The story is told of three ministers who were discussing the best posture for prayer. And in the background, in the room that they were discussing this, there was a telephone, a wine mirror. And one preacher who was very holy said, when I pray, my hands have to be folded. A second minister said, when I pray, I have to kneel. And a third minister said, he wasn't a Presbyterian, when I pray, I have to get prostrate on the floor. To which the lineman responded, I find the best position of prayer is when I'm hanging upside down 40 feet in the air. And that brings us to you now. As a church, we may be able to think of all the plans that we need to make. We feel a need to rush, perhaps. But what we really need to do is wait on the Lord and call out to Him in prayer. Because God sees Warrington Presbyterian Church. He hasn't left you. But He has His timing, and He has His ways. In the beginning of Herman Melville's book, Moby Dick, he begins with these words, call me Ishmael. Call me the God who hears. And I think as we end out this year, as we're into the final lap of it, go back to knowing that God hears. And what God also sees, He sees you. Let's pray and ask His blessing. Oh Lord God, we do need your blessing. Oh Lord God, we need you. Our plans have been frustrated. We don't know what exactly we should do at times. But our hope is in you. Because you know the fullness of your plans, and we don't. And part of our sin is that we're finite, and we often assume that we know more than what we do. Help us. Help us. Amen. And our